Chances are, if you're watching this, you've come through from episode 4 of Tenkara in Focus, where we featured an interview with Roberto Caligaric.
This is the after party.
What you're getting next is a very long sort of 30-minute video interview with Ubi. But we thought we'd preface it with just a little bit of sort of Ubi's history and our history. When we first met him in Japan, we'd got a lot in common because both Paul and myself are sort of, we have a very strong background in European competition methods, European nymphing techniques. And Roberto's a competition-winning angler in European competition fishing. And that foundation in the sort of the classic, modern, long, light line, pinpoint accuracy type fishing, it has a lot of similarities to Tenkara. Mm. And it let us, Paul, myself and Ubi, it let us hit the ground running when we first fished Tenkara, and it gave us a big, big sort of advantage on stream in Japan, fishing for pressured fish, difficult fishing situations.
Yeah, you can really see that convergent evolution, similar solutions in the kind of competition methods and in the survival methods of Tenkara. That really was the motivation for me to structure the email tutorials, the free email lessons in the way that I do.
Yeah.
Each building block and element that you get, I actually pull it out, one individual European competition method at a time, and some traditional methods as well, including wet fly fishing, that kind of thing. That gives you that kind of stepping stone lead-in to just be able to immediately, as John says, hit the ground running with Tenkara. It just makes it such an easy transition.
Yeah, putting it simply, you sign up for these email tutorials and you will get that solid foundation that helped us with our Tenkara.
Mm.
And it'll also help you with whatever type of fly fishing you decide you want to do.
It's universal. Fantastic. It's basically giving you the same benefits that we enjoyed, and that's what allowed us to kind of have a huge head start, essentially.
So, the interview is going to start now. We'll not keep it too long, but check around on screen. We'll probably have a link in the top corner, maybe a link in the description. If you're not receiving our free email tutorials, sign up now. I promise you won't regret it.
My name is Roberto Caligaric, and I was born in Milan, so northern part of Italy. I like to say though that I'm also half Belgian because it's part of my culture. So I'm a European citizen. So the first time I heard about Tenkara was like in Sanpei, small booklet, so manga, I should say. And that was the first time I saw Tenkara and I read about Tenkara, but I had no idea what Tenkara was, actually. And only several years later, I was like going through the web and looking through fly fishing website, and I found out this person called Ryuta, who was speaking about this Japanese style of fishing, fly fishing, and that's the first time I heard and I got a bit more details about Tenkara, and that was by beginning of 2011. And what happened next is that, like, to make a long story short, basically I met with Ryuta in the Central Park in Milan, and we take out of Tenkara rods, Ryuta Tenkara rods, and we start trying Tenkaras, and it felt just great. And so I was at the same time planning to go to Japan for a study trip, so 3 months over there. And I already know from Ryuta, already knew from Ryuta that there was a Masami Sakakibara over there. And so I decided it was a good idea to learn a little bit more about this technique and to take the opportunity by going through in Japan of looking directly from a Japanese point of view, at least from a foreigner's point of view in Japan. And over there, I was welcomed by Masami, and he first introduced me to Tenkara, and he invited me in his hut in the Toyama Valley. And that was the first time ever I learned how to cast with a Tenkara rod, yes. And it was a great experience. I gave Masami a lot of information about Italian traditional Valsesiana fly fishing style. And Masami, in exchange, gave me like a lot of information about Tenkara. And that's basically where my passion for Tenkara started, yes. It was kind of easier for me to get involved in the Tenkara world and culture because in parallel I was studying Japanese, and so learning Japanese language makes it much, much more easier to of course speak with the locals and learn from the people who actually invented Tenkara. So definitely it helps, and it helped and still helps a lot, yes. Speaking about how I was able to learn Tenkara, basically what helped me a lot also was that like I started as a 16 years old young guy learning fly fishing for competition. So I did competition in Italy for fly fishing competition, and I generally don't say that, but because I'm kind of proud. In 2010 I won the championship. So Youth championship. So the easier one, the easier one. So but anyway, like. Studying fly fishing for competition and learning to read the river. We used to say read the river in Italian, leggere il fiume. And basically this was just great because when I approached Tenkara, I already had a very good starting point and I could really see the differences and kind of also make a comparison on how Japanese people, Japanese fishermen were really observing the river and reading the river by themselves. So there is a kind of, rivers are books and everyone has its own style of reading kind of, or visualizing the words, let's say. So Italian fishermen do it in a way, Japanese fishermen do it in another way, and it's just amazing to see the differences and you can learn a lot through the process. So, yes, regarding the type of rods and lines that I generally use or that I generally prefer, this, let's say, it's a quite good question in the sense that, like, my thinkings about Tenkara are never really fixed. So I try to kind of like year by year and learning. And through the learning process, I try to add always something or learn more. And so my ideas always also changes from year to year. And at the beginning, for example, I started and I used mainly 3.5 meters long, 3.6 meters long rods. And now I happen to use mostly a 4.5 meter rod. And so, yeah. So basically right now, my favorite rod is a 4.5 meter rod, and because it gives me a lot of control over the line and the fly. I'm not a long line Tenkara fisherman. You barely have good control either when you cast and either when you have a big fish on your let's say on your rod. So I want to bring the fish to the net as fast as possible. So I want to keep a line of 4.5 meters or maximum 5 meters. Just to have a little bit more of reach. And I used the traditional Japanese, let's say, way of choosing the tippet length, which is the length of an arrow. So I draw my bow and that's my tip length, which on average for my length, my arm length, it's approximately about 1.2 meters or approximately that length. But when people in Italy ask me what should be the length of the tip or what should be the length of the line, generally as a starting point I always recommend like to stay a bit short, and it gives more control, gives more precision, and it makes more easy to cast. It's easier to cast and to catch fish, which is the important thing at the beginning. After that, you can study more and more if you want. And Tenkara is extremely simple. So making a discussion comparing thousands and thousands of rods, it's, at least to me, not very productive. Tenkara taught me to be minimalist, to stay simple. So I'm not using a Tenkara rod as my favorite rod. It's a 4.5 meter from Daiwa, which was made for keryu fishing, so bait fishing, which I then asked a friend to put a custom handle. And for me, it's the best Tenkara rod on the market. Not on the market, sorry. It's the best Tenkara rod for me because it's not on the market anymore, unfortunately. And so really, it's not a matter of brand. It's not a matter of like price. It's a matter of, the, at least to me, the rod that fits better your needs and your style. And but to start, of course, you can try different rods, and it's very nice, of course, to see the differences. And this was so rod, a line. It's very simple. I use generally level lines. I don't use taper lines because they cast too heavily. They are too much energy, the cast, and the fly just dropped too heavily on the water. So I use level lines, and I started with Masami with the line number 4, and then I fished a lot with Ajari, which is I consider him as a master of myself too, but he's actually a very good friend, and he's using level lines and light level lines, so I tended to use light level lines too, and now I'm using a size 2 level line. And regarding the tip, like I only use fluorocarbon, and the length of the the thickness of the tip, it will be generally 0.14. That's the one I use the most. And when the fish are spooky or I have special needs, I go up to 0.10 or 0.08. And flies, that's that's probably the most interesting part. A lot of people like flies, they like to have a lot of flies. My approach is the two approach fly. So there is a one approach fly, which I guess a lot of people misunderstood. I have recently been speaking with a Japanese friend, and he told me that the one approach fly was done in the past only for iwana fishing in the mountain streams and high mountain streams, where in the past, basically in the mountain stream, you had a lot of fish. So you can just cast anything and you will get a lot of fish. So one fly will be just enough. And that's the one fly approach. That's where the one fly approach come from the shokuryoshi. So the fishermen who just catch fish to sell it at izakaya or just for themselves to eat. So one fly approach for me now, today, with present condition of Japanese rivers or Italian rivers, not so much so productive. And I like to keep two flies. For one fly is for like when the fish is not active, and one fly is when the fish is active. So one fly will be, well, both flies can be fished both under the bottom of the water, so under the surface, sorry, not under, but under the surface of the water, and on the top of the water. But one is more productive on the top surface, as fished as a dry or just a little bit under the water. And that's what I call the Ryuta kebari, because it's the kebari from my very good friend in Italy. So we have a kind of interesting relationship. I got his fly as a second fly, and he got my fly as his second fly. So we are both using a two-fly approach, and we use the same flies. So regarding the fly size and how I tie these flies, like let's say, to start about hook size, for fly number one, so the Ryutake Bari, it's a, which is the fly that I mostly use to fish on the surface of the water, or to kind of make the fish aggressive. It's a hunting fly. In Italy, we call mosca da caccia, and it means really hunting fly, because when the fish is moving a little bit, but is not so active, with that fly, you really push on their nerves, and they just came out, and they are very angry, and they eat this fly. So anyway, to come to the hook size. So I need a hook size which is quite big. It has something, the fly has to disturb the fish. So typically the hook size will be 12, 10. Most common is 12, hook number 12, sometimes hook number 10, and in rare cases, number 14. Instead, and so to tie that fly, both me and Ryuta, to tie our flies, we try to use as less material as possible and very cheap materials. So something you can easily tie quickly. And Ryuta is a little bit more sophisticated than me, so he started with a very basic dressing, and he put like some wings, elk, basically elk wings. And the purpose of that is that the elk wing is made of white elk, like bleached elk. So you can follow the fly on the water and or under the water, and see very well how it moves and if a fish is biting it. So it's more like a really visual style of fishing. And my fly, instead, it's I call it Arike Bari. That's something Japanese people don't do. They don't give name to their flies. Well, I like to. So Arike Bari means simply ant kebari. So the purpose of my fly is to imitate ant. Ant, you can find it everywhere on the rivers, both in Japan, in Europe, England, Italy, everywhere. And fish feed on them. So I thought, oh, I should make an ant which has to be built quickly. And also, I don't want to fish it dry like a normal fly fishing ant, but I want to fish it deep and I want this fly to go deep on the bottom of the water. So I simply bought a 100 yen polyester thread, and the interesting thing of polyester is that it melts when you kind of fix it and you put glue on it, a special glue like a super attack. I don't know if you have this in England or not, but like it's a fast sticking glue, I don't know. Anyway, so the interesting effect is that when you mix this glue with the polyester, it melts and it makes a solid body which does not trap air bubbles. And that's the main target. So I didn't want to trap air bubbles, which actually slow down the flight, basically avoid the flight to go deep on the bottom. And that was one reason. And then I put only two turns of like hackles, just as minimum as possible, basically, to avoid air trapping again. And then I just enriched the dressing with something that's not really necessary, but for me it's important because it comes from my competition background, which is the red spot. And the small head is a fluo orange. It's really from competition background. And to me, it brings more fish. And Arikebari is, I generally make it in various sizes because it's my all-around pattern, basically. And from size number 12, not bigger, from size number 12 to size 18. And depending on the condition on the river, I'm using different sizes. Often when the fish are just, there is a big hatches and fish are rising, and basically, sometimes they are very selective. So in those cases, I use a very small Arike Bari. Otherwise, I use a 14 size for all around situations. And there is not too much to say about those two flies. So the interesting point, and I realized it actually later, is that I thought of like a normal, let's say, ant. And Ryuta later told me that his target was actually to imitate a flying ant. So if you think about it, like flying ants have like wings. Of course, they are flying ants. And but anyway, so the elk imitates also the wings. And so we have two ants in two different stages. And basically you can get plenty of fish with both of them. About the style of, let's call it my style of Tenkara. It's not really my style, but let's say the way I like to fish Tenkara, or the way I like to use my flies. So since my competition days, I was always been fascinated by the currents of the river. Currents are fascinating. They are going in all directions and you're not really able to control them. So you have to study them very well. And of course, fishing with nymphs, you have the advantage that the weight brings your fly automatically, or not automatically, but at least easily on the bottom of the river. But that's where the challenge comes with Tenkara, and that's where it actually gets very interesting for me. With Tenkara, you normally fish with wet flies at 10, 15 centimeters under the surface of the water, and you generally expect to see the fish eating the fly, even if it's eating under the bottom of the water. When I started Tenkara, I thought that a good challenge will be trying to basically get fish on the bottom of the river, on the bottom, basically under the water, deep under the water, without using weight. And that's, trust me, that's really a really big challenge. And it is possible, but it's very difficult. And either myself, either even if I'm studying and trying to do that, I'm not able to do it always. So it's something very, very challenging for me, and I'm still studying it right now. But basically, there are some conditions on the rivers that allow you to do that. And typically, when two currents meet, they kind of break the tension of the surface, or they actually create a lot of oxygen into the water. And this, basically, this oxygen creates empty spaces. And if you're able to put your fly with really pinpoint and precise cast in the right place, you are able to reach deep spots with a non-weighted fly. I first started thinking about that basically just as a pure challenge. Like I should say I like challenges, and even if Tenkara is very simple, I personally make it complicated with challenges. But that's me, it's just for the pure sake of the study. And then I found also that Ajari, my very good friend, liked to study currents too. And so I was observing him a lot, and I saw he was using currents a lot. He will not tell you that, but he's using a current movement a lot to put the fly exactly in the place he wants. So yes, so this is basically the condition, or like what I like to do the most. And when I am able to get a fish by putting my unweighted fly down in 1 meter, 1.5 meter water, that's the situation where I'm definitely, that's the most rewarding situation, definitely. And either big fish, small fish, iwana, mago, brown trout, all of these fish are very fun to fish, very fun to get. But if you fish those beautiful let's say animals, these big animals, the way you like, the way you want, and the way you fought, that's the most rewarding situation to me. Because I put a lot of effort in studying the river, and when the river actually proved that my thought was correct, that's definitely rewarding. I'm not stupid after all. That's what I think. So that's challenged, but finally it pays off. That's a very good question. I should say $1 million question. So, I will describe, I think the best advice I can give to people who are not able to access directly trustable information, or like, which is not so, let's say, obvious to get these days. Anyway, so people who cannot access this information, somehow they need a way to understand what Tenkara is about. And so my best advice would be like, try to challenge yourself, try to do exercises to use less and less and less and less equipment possible. So just to give an example, even when making flies, you can do excessive things. Reduce the step you use to make a fly. If you are making a fly which requires 5 or 6 steps on average, maybe it's very interesting, and you like fly tying, so that's perfectly understandable. But if you want to try to understand what Japanese Tenkara is, you should do a fly in 2 or 3 steps. 2 better. 3, two, it's kind of limit, so 3, it's okay, I should say. That's an example, for example, for flies, fly making. Then take these flies and go out fishing and forget about the fly. Focus on the movements you're doing on the river. Do less and less movements. Be more efficient. Use less energy. Be more comfortable when you cast. And you can actually apply this rule to everything. That's the interesting point of Tenkara. So the revolution of Tenkara for me is that it's actually teaching me a new way of living. This may sound exaggerating, and I know for some people it's just fishing, but to me it's teaching minimalism, which can be applied in all the aspects of your life. You can do very good things with very simple things and few things. So it's an exercise, basically. And not all people are willing to do exercises. So I will not recommend to people who just want to relax purely. It's an exercise, so it requires effort. This is probably one of the most difficult questions I've ever been asked, also by other fly fishermen before, but really, use less movement, less materials, less equipment as possible, and you will see that you will be able to melt with the river and nature in a way you was never been able to with other type of fly fishing or other type of fishing, because it actually become very spiritual at some point. So I don't want to go that far, because then it depends from people to person to person, but in my case, it's very borderline between spiritual and fun. So it's a mental exercise. So I'm sorry, it's a bit complicated to explain, but use less will be my best advice. And do this not only with Tenkara, but do this with your own life. It's really something I cannot stress enough. And you will get a very close view of Japanese culture and Japanese Tenkara, deep culture. That will be probably the only advice I can give, and it's not really easy to understand. You have people which actually, it's all about defining what you want to do with the technique. If you are like gear, if you like fly tying, if you like just you're passionate of catching a lot of fish, just like do it. That's Tenkara too. But if you want to be close to what the essence of Tenkara was at the beginning, at the origins, then you should try to be as simple as those fishermen were at the time, where no equipment was available, where fish was needed for a living. So life depended on that. It was life or death situation. So you just had to get the most with few things. And then you will get a very good idea of what the essence of Tenkara is. Then you can, once you get that, once you learn that, then you can do whatever you want with Tenkara. But please, first try to understand this. And then after that, innovate or do whatever you like. But there is no innovation without understanding the basics. So there is a lot of people in the world of Tenkara coming out now or even before, but sometimes their only target is just like, I will say it very clearly, it's money. They want to make a living of that, which in a sense is not wrong, because everybody wants to have a nice job or the job he likes. Yes. and live off that. So it's not wrong. But there are a lot of people who put a lot of time, effort of thinking that, with the only purpose of enrich their mind and other people's mind.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And if you use this information for mainly a commercial purpose, you will somehow be not so respectful of them. I know it's difficult to understand, and I know it's like a kind of, I mean, people are different, so way of thinking are different, and people are more focused on targets and they want to reach them quickly often. But yeah, I think trying to be a little bit more respectful, or at least listening a little bit more, will make things much better. Yeah, I think so. Yeah, somehow like I just hear people here and there like we want to sell 200 rods, we want to do this, we want to do that. And they ask me, Ubi, like what rod will you suggest to these people? What rod will you do? What do you think is the best product? And after all, I'm fishing with no Tenkara, a rod which is not Tenkara.
Yeah, yeah.
Just to show you that like you can improve with any tool you have in your hand. As far as your target is clear.
Yes.
It's very complicated things to say, but sometimes I got disappointed. And that's why actually I choose not to sponsor one brand or the other, even if I've been, if I had the opportunity to do that. Because it's give me more freedom of in like defining what is better, without being respectful to people who are doing Tenkara as a job. So, for example, if I'm like hired by a Tenkara rod manufacturer, I will necessarily have somehow to say good things about those rods, or at least, I don't know, at least not put it in the very bad perspective, even if I know the rod is crap. But I cannot accept that if a rod is crap, I cannot tell people buy this rod. So I necessarily have to keep the distances and say, guys, in my opinion, this is a good rod, but you can find a little bit better for maybe a cheaper price, or like, you know, it's really when market meets passion, it can be pretty messy. Yeah. And people change also very much, unfortunately. But so far, I have no particular. I'm happy with my thoughts. So I like to keep friendship with people, and I don't think it's worth to just to say bad things about the others. No point. No point.